Hi, our next topic is probabilistic graphical models. Probabilistic graphical models are used to model relations between many random variables. So, effectively, what we are going to do is we are going to produce the join probability of these variables. So, if x is a vector, the probabilistic graphical model gives us an efficient way to model these distributions. Pi x and something we would need to be able to take advantage of when we work with is that we are going to count the independent relations between these variables by somehow dropping some of the links from the graphs. That means if I have these two variables and they are not connected, in the graph that shows that they are independent. So the idea is that the join probability distribution, when it is factorized according to the graph, or if a graph is factorized to model the independence relations inside the probability distributions. So if we do that, we will be able to take advantage, or we can obtain inference directly from the graph itself. So if you are given with some random variables and learn the join probability distributions and somehow you can factorize it, you may be interested in getting some of the inferences out of this model. For example, if I know the probability of the first 10 variables, what is the probability of the remaining variables, etc. Now when you have a joint distribution like that, you will always be able to identify the parameters. One of the tasks in probabilistic graphical models is that to figure out what those parameters, given some realization of these random variables. Okay, so we will see some of the examples of these also. So, probabilistic graphical models are basically probability theory and plus graph theory. Okay, we need graphs because we can visualize the independence relations between variables, and we will be able to code or write programs or algorithms to solve multiple problems related with this data. So visualizing a probabilistic model is essential to write nice algorithms on that data. So we can write algorithms that take advantage of this graph structure. We would be able to do inference or learning and all of this effectively in a graph. For example, the message passing algorithm we may not be able to write without visualizing it properly using graphs. So the benefits you can gain insights into the model. You can look into the model graphically, so you can find things like how the random variables are correlated to each other. You can develop many algorithms by playing with the structure of the graphs. All and everything you need to know there is no need of knowing everything. All you need to know is that the sum and product rule of the probability. That's it. So the graph is going to encode the independence assumptions that exist in my random variables. Basically, we will be able to factorize the probability distribution on a graph, or given a graph, we would be able to say what sort of factorization the graph encodes given this probability distribution. The idea is to somehow observe this factorization of the joint probability distribution of a graph would be with local functions which are defined from the nodes of the graph. The local functions will be different for a directed graph, which are called Bayesian networks. And for undirected graph, they are called Markov networks or Markov random fields. Okay, but the idea is to somehow the joint distribution of variables can be represented as a product of local functions. So Bayesian networks are probabilistic graphical models defined on a directed graph. More clearly, on a directed acyclic graph, Markov random fields are probabilistic graphical models defined on undirected graph. So these are the two main types, and there can be some graphs in which there are some directed components and some undirected components as well, and you can form this in some unified way, and they are called factor graphs. And actually, at a later point of time, you will see that there is no one type and another type. We can unify the things into one type and all of these to the same type. Okay. In a graphical model, the lack of edges actually represents or it will imply conditional independence. So if I have these nodes representing random variables, let's say I have some 10 variables, and I connect every variable with every other variable, then there is no point in doing it with graphs, because the problem complexity never allows to make it less. But somehow, if some edges are missing, that represents immediately that some variables are not independent on some other variables. and that advantage can be taken. So the idea is we are interested in graphs which are not fully connected. So when they are fully connected, we may not be able to take the advantage of using graphs. That is, we know that in a real situation, not everything depend on everything, and we need to learn a rough part of these problems. Again, the lack of edges between vertices represent conditional independence, which we will discuss in a later session. In this picture, we will go from right to left. This is a directed graph. Here, A, B, and A, B, C are random variables. Maybe they can be continuous or discrete. It doesn't really matter. Here in the picture, you can see that C depends on A and B. E depends on C and D. The direction of the arrows shows the relation or the cause of the relation, the causal relationship. D doesn't depend on A, but E depends on D. The rest of such many inferences can be obtained or learned from this. The middle one, the undirected graph, there are no arrows in the edges. Obviously, if there are no arrows, C is dependent on B and D is dependent on C and B, and so on. So there is a click here which shows really correlations. So the first type is a type of a graph which unifies the other two graphs. To do that, we need to introduce the effect of fraction nodes. They represents local functions or local potentials which are present in directed or undirected graph. There are function nodes and that's why these are called factor graphs. Okay, so there are random variables and the other are fractions, functions, sorry, function. So using factor graphs we may be able to get all the inferences like in case of a directed graph or an undirected graph. So you can say that it unifies the things that can be done using directed or undirected graph. So nodes in a graph represents random variables and edges. Represent dependencies. Edges represents dependencies between two random variables, and actually we are interested in the lack of edges which represents independent random variables. Okay, so if you have many nodes with this some high dimensional space, each representing random variables, the first objective is to come up with a joint probability distribution, and in particular the factorized form of the joint distribution, joint probability distribution. The factorized form somehow can easily be visualized in a graph, accounting for whatever independent relations. If there are no independent relations and each of the variables can take k values, and let's say each of the variables are also discrete and takes k values, then how many variables you need to describe the joint probability distribution? If we have x1, x2, x3, etc., x7, sorry, xb, the power of b, right? So if b equal to 10, then you forget about it. You may not be able to do anything. Okay, so what we can benefit, take the advantage of conditional independence relations and graphs. Now, once how you can come up with the proper factorization of the graphs, then coming to the inference. Let's say you have measured the value of x, you know the value of x1, then you can find what is the value of x2 given x1, so that if the rest of the variables are independent, and you can marginalize them, etc. So the questions regarding independence can be answered by factorizing the joint probability distribution. Questions regarding the conditional probabilities also can be answered by marginalization and normalization operations. Okay, applications. Applications really are many. You just mention any field and you will find it. In bioinformatics, in medical diagnosis, for diagnosing diseases, there are systems available which has much better false alarm than the best doctors in the world. So now this is just not just for computer scientists or mathematicians. People from every field or industry are using probabilistic graphical models in computer vision, speech recognition. The speech translation system available in many places, it really works well with different peoples or different type of accent also, isn't it? Theoretically, every algorithm or problem in machine learning can be represented on a probabilistic graphical model. Error control codes are the places in which your system does a restart or identifies what has gone wrong. And it is really based on a probabilistic graphical model. You can also find applications in many different engineering fields and in natural language processing applications. So you can find applications of probabilistic graphical models in almost all the fields. Okay.